Hey everybody, it's Victorious Living. Welcome to the study. Anybody on yet? Begin to tag some friends. Let's have some fun. Who's on so far? It's 1 minute to seven, so we might be a little early. Welcome everybody. Hey, Jamaica. Hi, sweetheart. I miss you. I hope you're doing okay. Send me an emoji on how you're feeling tonight. Hey, Brenda, nice to see you. Hey, Nicole, all my favorite people. Hi there, girls, nice to see you. Hey, Donna, nice to see you tonight. Love you guys, too. Miss you so much. Hey, Nathan, nice to see you. Hope everything's going well with you. What a nice group tonight. So glad to see you. Yes, we love you all. That's right, Donna. Hope you've had a good day. We're just gonna chat for a little bit. Hey, Gabriella, my niece. Hi, sweetheart. She's from Michigan. Hi, sweetheart. I'm giving you a big kiss. Mwah. I'm glad to see you. Hi, honey. Hey, Julian, good to see you too. This is the best way that we can connect. Hey, Lisa, I'm glad to see you. Hope everybody had a good day today. Here in Florida, it was a gorgeous day. Is anybody getting outside? Is anyone enjoying? Hey, Jen, I'm so glad to see you. Mary, welcome. Oh, it's so nice to see you guys. There are some people that we're getting to get in touch with. I miss you too, Jennifer. We're getting to get in contact with that normally aren't in our group, so I'm just so happy about that. We're probably gonna have a visitor here in just a little bit. Somebody has just joined the set. Uh-huh, here we are. Well, I knew she was gonna come around, so those of you who have been dialed in early, we've already got a visitor. This is Miss Princess, as you might remember. She sure is pretty, but she's kinda naughty. All right, move along, little one. So hope you've had a good day. We've got a great teaching tonight. I'm so glad you're here. Yes, Brenda, she's the princess. I don't know if we're gonna get her to get off the desk tonight. We may have to share. Thanks, Mary. You would appreciate Pretty Kitty, wouldn't you? Hey, Diana, how are you, darling? I miss you. All right. So how is everybody? Everybody hanging in there? You guys are hilarious. We've got some competition here. She likes to nose around to everything on the desk. So with that, I'm not sure if we're gonna be able to stay intact here, but we're gonna try to hang on to everything we've got. Yeah, there's a tail flying through. Move along, little kitty cat. So nice to see you too, Diana. We miss you. We miss all you guys. I miss the hugs. So this is the best way that we can connect these days. Is this not crazy? Hey, Rhonda, I saw the picture of your kiddos in the pool on Facebook. It was awesome. Thank you for sharing that with the world. Well, I want to ask you a question. And we'll keep asking that question throughout tonight because I want to know how you're doing. I want you to tell us in just a few words, what is your greatest challenge during this season? And as we see that coming up on the screen, this is going to give us an opportunity to pray for each other. We're going to get to see what kind of challenges you have. So please, oh my goodness. There's a huge raccoon out the window. Well, there goes Princess. That got her attention. The raccoon's about the size of Princess. Well, you never know what's going to happen here in this study. Yesterday, Princess was on the chase for it with a baby lizard. And just for some fun, I turned around and I heard this crunch, crunch, crunch. Princess had a snack. So everybody say it together. Ew! She didn't eat a snack that day. Oh, gracious. Hey, Bonnie is there too with Julian. Yay. Say hi to Barb too. Love you guys. So let us know what your greatest challenge is as the season continues. Just kind of share with one another. And then what we get to see, we get to see your comment, and then we get to pray for you. Because there are some challenges, aren't there? Anybody seen any? So share, huh, Brenda? Brenda's saying emails. Yes, Brenda, but you're learning every day, aren't you? Yay. While we're waiting for more people to pop on, I want to just give some reminders of some things happening here at Church of the Cross this week. Every single day at 1 o'clock is a connection time with COTC Family Live. It's a time to get updated. There's some encouragement, there's a prayer time, and Karen and Courtney do it Monday through Thursday. And if you've been watching it, sometimes it's really funny, isn't it? I'll be on Fridays, and I don't know if I can be wild and crazy like they are. I guess I'm just gonna have to be me. But on Fridays, I will be doing the COTC Family Live. Nathan, I see that. Challenges of not seeing everybody in person. Jamaica, I'm so sorry. Yes, people are losing jobs, and we're sorry to see that a coworker has lost her son. I'm so sorry. Marjorie, I'm so glad to see you, honey. Welcome. Rhonda, I agree with you. The 1 o'clock is awesome, the 1 o'clock devotion time. Tomorrow night, Thursday, on COTC live streaming, Pastor Jeff is going to do a prayer time. As you know, our church has always done a prayer time at 8 in the morning. Well, it's going to be live streaming 7 o'clock at night. So that's something to join in with. And then on Friday night, there's going to be a couple opportunities. Church of the Cross is having a Good Friday service at 7 o'clock, again, live streaming. Because our audience with Break Free Friday Night Live is expanding, I'm going to go ahead and have Break Free Friday Night Live 7 o'clock Friday night through the Break Free Facebook page. So exactly how you got in here. God has given me a word for the next few weeks in Break Free, so join in with us. But if you want to join the Good Friday service, please, please do. We're just going to make that available as well. So, yay. Of course, there's going to be Easter services on the weekend. We're going to celebrate the risen Savior. Even though we can't be at church, Easter isn't canceled. Can I get an amen out there? Praise God. Thank you for sharing some of your challenges. What I'm asking is, what kind of challenges are you having in this season? Donna, I agree with you. Goodwill is closed. Mary, working in circles and not being productive. Sometimes that is a real challenge. I agree. I'm so glad that you've joined us. I'm going to jump in and talk about our study. Remember, we've had some homework, and the homework has been reading Daniel chapters 1 through 6 in preparation for each week. So thank you for doing that. We're doing a study on Daniel, and what's amazing to me, guys, is how much that parallels his crisis and the crisis we're in. And I believe God is going to speak to us. So tonight, chapter 2 in the book of Daniel, character out of chaos. I think we said last week, we all agree that we are in crisis, and isn't it a bit chaotic? And I love how the book of Daniel talks about the importance of character and the power of good character and an uncompromised life, especially when the pressure's on. Daniel was an ordinary person just like us. However, he faced very many extraordinary challenges. There's a lot of parallels that we see. Who would think that the beginning of 2020, when we were celebrating a new year, that we would be where we are today? Stay at home, businesses closed unless you are deemed an essential business, lockdown, no church gathering. How about your favorite restaurants closed? A pandemic? What? Good thing God is never taken by surprise. Praise God for that. Who knew that our lives were going to be slowing down like they are? That's pretty amazing, isn't it? And then there's Daniel. He and his Jewish buddies, I'm sure they never thought that their lives would be interrupted by human trafficking, by a king that was doing an experiment. Hey, Abra, I'm so glad to see you. Love you, sweetheart. But here we are with Daniel. And here we are, precious friends. Again, thank you for joining us. What we do with the interruptions of life is really the key. Instead of asking why, I've got a couple questions that we should be asking. Hey, Judy, nice to see you, sweetie. Miss you, girls. So a couple questions. Number one, perhaps we should be asking our Heavenly Father, how do you want me to view this situation? And question number two, what do you want me to do right now? What do you want me to do with it? Good questions. And from God's perspective, do you think that could change our perspective and how we react to this situation? Guys, we don't want to go back to life as usual and just say, well, that was this and off we go. Don't you want to be changed? Don't we want to be better? Don't we want to love each other more and draw closer to the Savior? Daniel, as we're going to see again, is a great example of character, integrity, operating in a spirit of excellence during these very difficult times in Jewish history in the book of Daniel. Connie, love to you. Thank you for joining tonight. Well, let's open with prayer and then let's jump into our study. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the opportunity to meet. Thank you for technology that we could do that together. Father, I ask that you bless my precious friends, all those that are joining, and those that will be seeing the broadcast at a later time. Father, pour your spirit out. We need to hear from you. In Jesus' name, amen. We're beginning in chapter 2 of Daniel. And as we begin, King Nebuchadnezzar is the focus. Now, King Nebuchadnezzar was one of the greatest world leaders at that time. In fact, he was the first person to conquer the entire civilized world. So at that time, he was a very big deal. But as chapter 2 opens, the king has insomnia. He had a dream, and it's very, very puzzling. So he's called in his wise men. Basically, they were his psychics. And these guys were the people that he consulted on important matters. So the king would tell these wise men his dream, and they would always interpret it. However, this particular dream was the wise men's worst nightmare. And let me explain why. Do you have your Bibles? Let's open up to Daniel. We're in chapter 2. You may want to grab a pencil and paper because I do have some very important points that you may want to refer to. And again, I believe God's going to speak to us tonight. Let's go to Daniel chapter 2, verse 5. And the king threw these wise men a curveball. Let's look at verse 5. "This is what I have firmly decided," said the king. "If you do tell me what my dream was and interpret it." In other words, he said, "I'm not going to tell you the details of the dream." He wanted to test their abilities. "You're the psychics, you're the wise men. You tell me what the dream was and then interpret it." Now their penalty, if they couldn't tell him the details of the dream, is found in verses 5 and 6. Oh, this is charming. "I will have you cut into pieces and your houses turned into piles of rubble. But if you tell me the dream and explain it, you will receive from me gifts and rewards and great honor." Oh, yay. That's awesome. Unless they can't tell the dream, then they're going to be cut into pieces. Now, the wise men were running out of options. Let's look at verse 7. They answered again and said, "Let the king tell his servants the dream, then we'll give its interpretation." Look at verse 11. "It's a difficult thing that the king requests, and there is no other who can tell to the king except the gods," that's a little g, "whose dwelling is not with the flesh." The wise men were running out of options, and the king was running out of patience. So now in verse 12, things are starting to get a little dicey. Oh, let's see what's happening. Verse 12, "For this reason, the king was angry and very furious and gave the command to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. So the decree went out and they began killing the wise men, and they sought Daniel and his companions to kill them." Did you notice that Daniel and his three friends were part of the wise men of the king? All of these guys were graduates of the king's college. Now the king's commander set out on a killing spree to all the wise men, and guess who was at the top of the list? You got it, Daniel. Daniel, once again, his life is one pressure cooker. Have you noticed that? How will he respond as the pressure continues to mount? Daniel was facing impossible demands. What's he gonna do? Now, remember, the wise men already said, it's impossible to tell the king what the dream was. But let's recall that Daniel is not your usual wise man of the king, right? He knows God. He knows a God that specializes in the impossible. How about you? How about you? Do you tap into the God of the impossible? No matter what it's like for you, no matter what challenges, and you're talking about some of the challenges that you're having. But God is the God of the impossible. And Daniel, and us too, face impossible demands that are beyond human impossibilities. Finances, jobs, health, relationships, all of that from a human perspective, wow, this is tough stuff, isn't it? And you wonder, this is too hard. How are we going to get through it from a human perspective, right? Sure. Let's look at Mark 10:27. Jesus looked at them and said, Jesus is speaking, with men it is impossible, but not with God. For with God, all things are possible. Ah, amen. I love that, don't you? Don't get caught up in the darkness of the impossibilities. If you spend a lot of time on TV, a lot of time watching all the news broadcasts that are coming on social media, be very careful with that. We've talked about that before. That's tough because we're taking in all that darkness. Like I've said before, it's okay to be informed, but then let God, the God of the impossible, take it. Isn't that good? Give me some emojis on that. That's a good thing. I want to know you're still out there. I want to know you're still listening. God is the God of the impossibilities. We know that our God specializes in the impossible. Ah, because we know we can't. So don't get caught up in that. But let this scripture, Mark 10:27, be the song of your heart during this difficult season. But with God, all things are possible. I feel better already. How about you? I'm feeling better. I'm feeling more up. I'm feeling more energized. Daniel knew how to respond. Yes, it is fantastic news, Diana. Now, Daniel, and I love this part. Daniel was a master of how to use wisdom and tact. We're going to get a really good lesson from the Word of God on how to conduct conversations that are impossible. So let's imagine what this situation looks like. Let's create it. Daniel's in his home, and there's a knock at the door. Daniel, remember, who is just a young teen, goes to the door, and the commander of the king is there, sword in hand, and he shows up ready to kill Daniel instantly. Can we say, tough day, huh? But Daniel had no panic, no fear. You know who answered the door? The wisdom of God. Now, I'm going to read this out of the New Living Translation in verse 14. When Arioch, the commander of the king's guard, came to kill them, Daniel handled the situation with wisdom and discretion. Verse 15, he asked Arioch, "Why has the king issued such a harsh decree?" So Arioch told him all that had happened. Did you see how calm Daniel was? He wasn't upset. He wasn't even on his knees pleading for his life. Even when his life was threatened, he didn't lose his temper and he was not in a panic. He showed wisdom and tact, but he boldly asked for the facts. Now, wisdom is the ability to know what to do and say the right thing. We need that wisdom. However, tact is the ability to say the right thing. You know what we do? We say, it's not what you say, it's how you say it. Well, it's important on how you say as well as what you say. Daniel had a God-given ability for both. And this is not the first time, and can I tell you, not the last time, we're going to see Daniel not only say the right thing, very respectful with godly wisdom, but knowing how to say it. Daniel is an amazing example of a godly man. We need wisdom intact in our life, don't we? Yes, we do. Praise God. And I'm sorry, my phone was ringing. You know, I see that Daniel was cool as a cucumber in the middle of a life-threatening situation. Don't you find that amazing? We know that was just God, and he was prepared for his next move. During difficult times, do you seek God alone? Do you add some prayer warriors with you? That's what Daniel did. Daniel began piecing together a prayer strategy. Don't you love that? So do I. And we need to know where our help comes from, and our help comes from the Lord. So a strategy is being put together in prayer by Daniel and his friends. And this is the cool thing. Daniel is so brave. He goes to the king. Oh, praise God. He goes to the king one more time. Why? He had already been in prayer. He had sought godly wisdom. And Daniel, don't panic. Press the pause button. Would you agree sometimes that we move too quickly? We move too fast. We think we've got to move really, really fast with the decision. What? About if we slow it down and press the pause button instead of making those snap decisions. Daniel knew that he needed wisdom. He needed to be still, praying, and waiting on God. So Daniel went to his three friends and they prayed and asked God to reveal a mystery. Complete and total dependence on God. Wow, this is brave. This is so brave. Complete dependence on God, utterly and totally dependent in the middle of this desperate situation. What about you? Are you right now in a desperate situation? Maybe even applying for unemployment. Is that a little challenging? Oh, yes, it is. So guys, how about going to God, the God of the impossible? Losing jobs, laid off from jobs, on furlough from jobs, home with the children, homeschooling. Oh my goodness, there's a myriad of so many desperate situations. But what about if we're quiet and still and pray and ask for the wisdom of God? What an example Daniel is. Stop, rest, and seek his guidance. The Apostle Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians 1, 8 through 11, in the New Living Translation, he talks about a desperate situation. Let me give you that scripture again. 2 Corinthians 1, 8 through 11. We think you ought to know, dear brothers and sisters, he's telling his brothers and sisters after the fact, about the trouble we went through in the province of Asia. We were crushed and overwhelmed beyond the ability to endure, and we thought we would never live through it. Verse 9. In fact, we expected to die. But as a result, we stopped relying on ourselves. Amen. And learned to rely only on God who raises the dead. And he did rescue us from mortal danger, and he will rescue us again. We have placed our confidence in him, and he will continue to rescue us. I love this. He is speaking directly to us in our situation right here, right now. Hey, Michelle, thanks for joining us, sweetie. It's speaking directly to us. Don't rely on yourself. Don't try to figure it out. Don't try to get all frustrated and upset because you're trying to work out a situation. In this overwhelming season, learn to rely on God alone. Let's look deeper at Daniel's strategy. I love this, guys. I love how in every chapter, Daniel has a prayer strategy. Excuse me. Daniel's first response was always dependence on God to pray. And he asked his friends to join him. Prayer preceded any action that Daniel was going to take. That was his first response. Can I ask you, what's your response in a desperate panic situation? That's a good thing to ask, isn't it? I hope it's just like Daniel, prayer, total and utter dependence on God. So we're going to look at 4 points of prayer strategy. Oh, I love this. I hope you've got a pencil and paper. This is going to speak to us tonight. 4 points of our prayer strategy. Number one, when you need wisdom, just ask. I love the simplicity of that. We cannot hope for any effective strategy in a pressure situation without prayer. Right? Right? Give me some thumbs up, guys. Right? Prayer should always be our first defense, never our last resort. So James 1:5 says this, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to them. Oh, praise God. So if you need wisdom, what do? You ask, and God will give you as much as you need. He gives it liberally. He's not gonna hold back. He's gonna give it. But the key is you've got to ask. As soon as we face a problem, we pray. We ask God to give us wisdom. And can I tell you, through many years of experience, using the wisdom of God and prayer as the first offense or first defense, wisdom works every time. And what I have found is when you pray and ask for God's wisdom in a situation, He moves quickly. He moves quickly. He's just waiting for us to ask for His wisdom. The key is to get ourselves out of the way and watch the wisdom of God work. We need to get ourselves out of the way. You know, we're not all that in a bag of chips. We know that, don't we? Okay, so that was number one. Number one is when you need wisdom, just ask. Prayer strategy number two, pray specifically. I love this. Daniel's strategy involved a specific request. This is going to speak to us. He said, God, I need to know the king's dream. Now, that's not a big fancy prayer, is it? But it's all the prayer that was needed. Daniel needed a specific answer, and he prayed a specific prayer. Could it be, dear ones, that we're not receiving answers to our prayers because we're being too general rather than making specific requests? Let me give you an example. Do we say, Father, I pray for this person, and I pray about this situation, and I pray about this pandemic? Is that a specific prayer? No, it's not. We're saying, I pray for this, I pray for that, but what is your specific request? God is waiting. Hey, Stephanie, glad you joined us. God is waiting for us to be specific. We have to give him permission to enter into our situation, and that's what prayer is about. Prayer is giving God permission to come into our situation. So we need to be specific. God wants to answer, but we need to be specific. That's going to help somebody, I believe. Prayer strategy number three, pray persistently. Now, Daniel prayed and kept on praying. Remember, outside the door is Arioch and his sword. So a little bit of a pressurized situation. He had an urgent request and he kept on praying. He could not stop. The king's guard was waiting to execute him. So Daniel was praying effectively for God to come through. Our problem might be, precious ones, is we stop too soon. We get tired of waiting. We give up when all kinds of doubt are coming our situation. Pray persistently. It's okay to do that. Lastly, prayer strategy number four, prayer and praise. I'm telling you, Daniel had it going on. Because of Daniel's prayer composure, God communicated to Daniel the king's dream in a vision. God answered the prayer. But listen, when Daniel praised God for the answer, he praised God because he trusted and believed God for the answer, and he was convinced that the message that God had given him was the answer, so he praised him. Look at verse 23. This is the prayer of praise by Daniel. He just said in advance, I thank you and praise you, O God of my fathers. You have given me wisdom and might. That's the prayer of faith. And have now made known to me what we asked of you. For you have made known to us the king's demand. I love Daniel's faith in his God, don't you? I agree with you, Nathan. Fervent prayer. Could we take a page out of Daniel's prayer book? I think so. Could this be our prayer during these troubled times? Absolutely yes. Amen. So Daniel teaches us some things. The best time to thank and praise God is when we pray and give the request. Right after we ask him, let's thank him and praise him for the answer. We can't wait for the visual evidence of answered prayer. We must go ahead and thank him in advance, and God honors our faith. Now, hang on to your seat. Fasten your seatbelt if you need to, for this next portion of scripture, okay? If you aren't familiar with this scripture, it's going to knock your socks off. We're going to go back to James 1:5, but we're also going to add verses 6-8. So let's look at that. James 1:5, we've already read this. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to them. Good, we know that. But verse 6 is still talking about prayer. Let's listen. But let him ask in faith with no doubting, for he who doubts is like a wave of sea driven and tossed by the wind. Verse 7. For let not that man, the man that's praying and being tossed all over the place, suppose that he'll receive anything from the Lord. Uh-oh. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all of his ways. Okay, let's look at the writer of the book of James. Yes, it is James, but James is the half-brother of Jesus. So he knows a lot. Why? Because he grew up with his older brother and saw the faith of God operate through the Son of God, Jesus Christ, on a daily basis. So James knows how faith works. Let's talk about some key scriptures, or I'm sorry, some key words in this scripture. Ask in faith and don't doubt. Now that's a tall order. We may have to work up to that. But if we doubt with our prayer, we're gonna feel like we're tossed and riding on a wave, being tossed up and down and hither and yon, believing and doubting, just like that wave going up and down, up and down. What happens to a guy that prays like this? The scripture says, don't think for a moment, he will receive anything from God. Can we all say ouch? Why? Because he's double-minded. He's unstable in all of his ways. He's riding the fence. Yes, God will answer. Oh, I'm not sure if he's going to. Can I ask you, dear ones, today, if you're wondering why your prayers aren't being answered, if you're going, God, why? I'm praying, why? Maybe it's because of James 1, 6 through 8. Strong words, I know, but do we want answers to our prayer? Everybody say, yes, we do. Of course we do. So James is instructing us, this is how you get answers. You don't doubt. You're not thrown all over, doubting and believing and not sure and maybe, and yes, God answers, no, he doesn't. Because this guy is double-minded and unstable in all of his ways, and that guy won't receive anything from God. Why? How's God going to answer that prayer? He believes, he doesn't believe. We need answers to our prayers, and I believe God has just revealed to someone that's listening today why your prayers aren't being answered. You've been asking God, why? I'm praying, I'm not getting the answer. You're not getting the answers because you're in unbelief. I would suggest, dear ones, to read and meditate on James 1, 6 through 8, and really get a hold of that and let God, the Holy Spirit, teach you. So let's go back to Daniel. That was some good prayer strategy, wasn't it? Didn't you enjoy that? I did too. So what happened to Daniel? Let's look at verse 24. The king's commander ran to the palace and said, stop the presses! Don't execute the wise men. Look at verse 25. We're going to read 25 through 28, so bear with me while we read that portion of scripture. Then Arioch quickly brought Daniel before the king and said thus to him, I found a man, one of these guys that was a captive from Judah, who will make known to the king the interpretation. The king answered and said to Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar. Now you might remember last week that the king changed all the names of the Jewish men. He wanted to name them names of pagan gods. So Daniel's name was changed to Belteshazzar. Are you able to make known to me the dream which I've seen and its interpretation? Verse 27, Daniel answered in the presence of the king. Now get this, don't miss it, guys. This is the clincher, and said, the secret which the king has demanded, the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, and the soothsayers cannot declare to the king. But there's a God in heaven. Ah, isn't that awesome? But there's a God in heaven who reveals secrets. And he has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar that will be in the latter days, your dream and the visions of your head upon your bed. Okay. Let's look at this pressure-packed situation. Daniel demonstrated grace and focus on the God of heaven. Now, at this point, everybody's head is on the chopping block, all these wise men, including Daniel and his three buddies. Daniel could have said, "Hey, I've got the answer. What you need, King, I've got." He could have thrown everybody under the bus. But with grace and mercy, with wisdom, with tact, his focus was the God of heaven. What's your pressure-packed situation today? Is it pressure-filled on every way? This is a good lesson for us, but there's a God in heaven. Oh, I love that. Praise God. Daniel's theme of his life is there's a God in heaven and he's able to deliver us. Whatever your pressure is today in this season, the season that feels so strange, know that God is able to deliver you. The situation is not too impossible for our God. Ah, oh, praise God. Believe that. Declare that. That was in Daniel 2, verse 28. That would be a great scripture. Don't doubt it. Declare it and believe it. God is able to deliver us. We're going to come out of this, dear believers, stronger on the other side. We're going to come out closer to the Savior and changed people and more in love with him. Ministry may look different. Your job may look different. It may look better. Let's trust God. There's a God in heaven. Don't you love how Daniel just surrendered it all? I love that. Whatever your situation is, whether you're working from home, helping the kids at home, just hanging out and waiting this for this thing to get over, dear one, please remember there's a God in heaven that will deliver you. As we pray and close tonight, I want to pray for you. You expressed some challenges, the kids at home, jobs, some loss, just waiting, and maybe the fear factor has crept in. Those of you having a hard time, maybe lonely, maybe some of you even ill. I want to pray for you today, and let's join our faith together like Daniel did with his three friends. Let's join our faith together and believe that there's a God in heaven that will deliver. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the answer. We thank you and praise you already that those that are lonely and fearful and those that are having a hard time, give those wisdom on their jobs, wisdom on the computers. Help the kiddos and the parents with schooling. And God, there are some needs out there that only you know. So we join our faith together as believers in Christ. We do not doubt. We believe and we declare that there's a God in heaven and he will deliver them. And we declare that this pandemic will be over soon. And God, we want your perspective during this time. We love you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. So a few announcements for those of you that joined a little bit later. Just a reminder that at 1 o'clock every day, COTC Family Live is doing a devotional. It's fun. There's the Word of God. There's prayer. Yay. Thursday night, tomorrow night, 7 o'clock, prayer time, live streaming by Pastor Jeff. And then if I may mention again, thanks for your amens, girls. If I may mention again, we will have Break Free Friday Night Live, 7 o'clock, right back here. For those of you that want to live with the live streaming for the Good Friday service, please join. We've got people from other states who are not at our church. I just want to make myself available 7 o'clock Friday. So we'll be here. But if you want to zip on over, you can catch our broadcast later. Remember that God is able to deliver you from anything that you're dealing with. Know that you are loved. I miss you. I love you. And don't forget, guys, to connect with one another. Thanks for joining the live streaming tonight. I love streaming with you. God bless you. Have a great evening. And we'll be right back here next time. Love you guys. God bless.